VectorShift is an AI automations platform that makes it easy to create AI solutions without writing a single line of code. Using a simple drag-and-drop user interface, you can create a chatbot that is trained on your own data within minutes. VectorShift is a workflow automation platform, which means we can do a lot more than just creating chatbots. We could set up a cron job to run our automation daily, which will do some sort of research on our behalf and then post the results to something like Slack. Or we could set up a trigger on our email, which then uses AI to respond to our emails on our behalf. In this video, I will show you how you can build a chatbot which you can embed into a website, integrate with WhatsApp, or use as a standalone application. Our chatbot will be able to answer questions using a knowledge base, like a website or documents, and I will also show you how you can set up VectorShift to automatically update the knowledge base as well. To get started, go over to VectorShift.ai, and the first thing we want to do is to create an account. But before we do that, let's have a look at the pricing options. VectorShift offers a very generous starter plan, which is free to use, and this is the plan that you can use to follow along with this tutorial. But of course, you can also upgrade to one of their paid plans if you enjoy this platform. Let's go ahead and create our account by clicking on Get Started. After creating your account, you will be presented with this dashboard. From here, you can view all of your pipelines, and pipelines are basically our chat applications. And at the moment, I have this one pipeline, but for you, you might see an empty page with a big button prompting you to create your first pipeline. On the left-hand side, we can see the menu, and let's have a look at Marketplace. From Marketplace, you can view example pipelines, and you can also import them into your own account. Then under Storage, we can add new files or data sources to our knowledge bases, and we will have a look at that in this video. Then under Automations, we can set up triggers for our pipelines. As an example, if we wanted our pipeline to be automatically triggered on a fixed schedule, we could set up a cron job, or we could set up Gmail to trigger our pipeline when we receive new emails. Moving on to chatbots, this is where we will see our chatbot that we will create during this video. And we can also use the screen to view past conversations with our chatbots. Then, evaluations allow us to run tests and evaluate our pipelines. We can use the search page to run tests against our knowledge bases. Then under transformations, we can add our own Python logic, which we can call from our code. Now let's start by creating our first chatbot. Let's go back to pipelines and let's click on new. From this pop-up, we can select from a range of templates, which we won't do in this video. Instead, let's click on create pipeline from scratch. You will now be presented with this empty canvas. So at the top, we can view all the different nodes that we can add to our canvas. We can also click on search to search for a specific node. Then at the top right, we have the option to deploy our pipeline, to run the pipeline, or we can set details like the pipeline name, the description, user permissions, etc. And at the bottom right, we have the options to zoom in and out of the canvas and to fit all the nodes into a single view. So let's start by adding an input node as well as an output node. We can then connect these two nodes by dragging a line from the input node to the output node. And at the moment, this isn't really doing much. It's simply taking the value from the input node and passing it to the output node. Let's go ahead and test this by clicking on run. And on the screen, we actually have two views. We have the standard view and the chatbot view. We can also change the size of this window by dragging these three dots on the left-hand side. And let's say something like hello, and let's press enter. And I'm simply getting hello back from the bot because we are simply passing the input from this node to the output node. We can see the same thing under the standard view by passing a value into input like hello. And when we run this, we will see that the output is also hello. On the canvas, we can also see below each of these nodes a little green tick, indicating that this node was executed successfully And we can also see that the output node was also executed successfully. Now let's have a look at these nodes in a bit more detail. On each of these nodes, you will find a little info icon, and clicking on that will open up the documentation for that specific node. And on some of these nodes, you will also see a video tutorial for that node. We can also delete a node by clicking on this cross twice. Let's add this input node back. It's connected again to the output node, and we can also right-click on a node to duplicate the node, view its documentation, or delete it. Now, before we start with the fun stuff, let's also have a look at variables. We can break this connection by clicking on this cross twice, and let's add this text node. This text node simply allows us to set a variable which we can use throughout this pipeline. Don't worry though, this is really not complicated, and variables do play a big role in these pipelines. I'm actually going to delete the value that's already in here just to show you how this works. Let's enter a value like "Hello Leon," and let's pass this to our output node. We will leave the input node disconnected for now. Now, watch what happens when we run this pipeline. We can actually enter anything in the input because this will be ignored. So let's simply run this, and we can see that the value from this text node is being returned by the output node. Now, let's say we wanted the name to be a dynamic value which we pass from the input. At the moment, there's no way to connect this input node to this text node, and we can fix that by defining a variable. There are two ways to create a variable. First, you can enter double curly braces, then the name of the variable, like name, and we can then enter two closing curly braces. And this will now create a new input for this node called name. Another way to easily create a variable is to simply click on this insert variable button, and we can then give our variable a name, like name. We can now connect our input node into this name input, and when we test this, let's enter something like John, let's run this, and now we're getting that dynamic value. Awesome. Now let's move on to something a bit more fun, because after all, you are here to learn about creating chatbots. Let's delete this text node, and let's go to this LLM menu item. Here we can see all the large language models that are available within VectorShift. Let's select the OpenAI node. For now, let's put this input node aside, and let's only focus on the OpenAI node and the output node for now. Let's connect the response of our LLM to the output node. So whatever gets produced by this OpenAI node will be passed to the output node and written to the screen. For the OpenAI node, we have to specify a system message as well as a prompt. The system message is simply a way to provide instructions to the model. This way we can set its role, its personality, and any other restrictions. For instance, let's say something like, "You are a pirate called John." The prompt is usually the question or the message from the user. So we could type something like, "Hello," and we will connect the input node in a second, but let's first focus on the basics. And I'm actually going to change the model to GPT-4 Turbo Preview. The nice thing about VectorShift is that we do not have to specify our own API key, but if you wanted to, you could simply check this use personal API key and then paste in your OpenAI API key. Let's go ahead and run this. And I'm actually going to switch over to the chatbot view, and we can actually enter anything, and let's press enter. And we are getting a response back from our AI model, and it is responding like a pirate. So let's change this hard-coded prompt from "hello" to whatever we pass in from the input node. The way I recommend you do this is, let's delete the text that was there, and we could simply connect the input node to this prompt input on the model, and this will work perfectly fine. Let's test this out by saying something like, "What is your name?" And let's run this. And we do get the correct response back. Awesome. But the way I would recommend writing the prompt is to replace the prompt, is to enter something like question, and then below question, let's add a new variable, and let's call the variable question. And we can then connect our input node to the question input. And you will see why we need to do this in a second, but basically by using variables, we will be able to inject additional information into the prompt, like the chat history or context from a knowledge base. Now that we've made this change, let's go ahead and test this in the chat by saying something like, tell me a joke. And indeed, we do get the correct response back. Now, the next step is to add our own knowledge base to this application. And this is useful for creating customer support chatbots or any type of chatbot that needs access to your specific data. But first, if you enjoy this video, then please hit the like button and subscribe to my channel. And I also want to thank VectorShift for sponsoring this video. Now let's have a look at adding our knowledge base. To add a knowledge base, we can simply click on the knowledge base menu over here, and then let's click on knowledge. This will add this knowledge base reader node to the canvas. This node takes in a query as input. It will then use this query to look up all the relevant documents from a knowledge base, and then we can connect the results to any other node. So for the query, let's actually take our input and connect it to this query as well. So now we have our input connected to both the question variable on the model, and we're also passing it to the knowledge base reader. Now we just have to set up our knowledge base. We can either select from a list of pre-existing knowledge bases, or we can create a new knowledge base. Let's do that now. Let's give our knowledge base a name, and in order to demonstrate this knowledge base feature, I'm actually going to scrape information from a website. And more specifically, I'm actually going to scrape information from this LangChain expression language page in the LangChain documentation. And I want users to be able to ask questions about LCEL in my chatbot. But of course, you can add whatever knowledge base you want. So I'm going to call this LangChain documentation, and I'll just copy this and use this as the description as well. And let's click on confirm. Now we can add information to this knowledge base by clicking on add document. Here you have a list of several options. You can upload files by clicking on file, and then you can click on this add button to upload files from your machine. Or we can add integrations. Let's click on add integration. And here you can connect Airtable, Copper, Discord, Gmail, and many other data sources. We can also add URLs, which is what I'm going to do. You can also add recursive URL, which means that you can provide a URL and VectorShift will automatically scrape all the sub URLs as well. You can also link to Wikipedia pages, YouTube videos, archive, and GitHub repositories. I'm going to select URL. Let's copy this LangChain URL. Let's paste it in here. And here we can see another very cool feature about VectorShift. We can tell VectorShift to automatically update the knowledge base by selecting from this dropdown. And here we can tell it to rescrape this information daily, weekly, or monthly. And this could be useful for something like an online store where your products and prices change on a regular basis. I'll just leave this as never, and let's click on add. We can now wait until the status changes to complete, which it is, and let's close this pop-up. So now we can ask a question about the LangChain documentation. This knowledge base reader will fetch the most relevant information from the knowledge base, and we can now inject those results into our final prompt. So how do we do that? Let's change this prompt slightly. Let's add context to this prompt with a variable called context, which now creates the second input over here. So let's connect the results of our knowledge base to this context input. Awesome. So now we can ask a question, and hopefully the model will be able to answer the question from the context. But to get this to work, we do need to change the system prompt to instruct the model to only answer the questions from the context. So we could enter a system prompt like, you are an AI assistant. Answer the user's questions from the provided context. Do not make up your own answers. Keep the answers concise and to the point. Let's go ahead and test this out. Let's click on run. Then let's ask something like, what is LCEL? Let's run this, and we can see that the correct response is indeed being fetched from our knowledge base. I really like the way that VectorShift implemented knowledge bases. If we want to add to this knowledge base, we can simply click on edit knowledge base, and we can go ahead and add additional documents, and we can add different types of documents as well. And from this view, we can also delete from the knowledge base, and we can use this setting to change the frequency on which VectorShift needs to re-index this information. Under advanced settings, we can also change the chunk size the chunk overlap, and we can even change the embedding model. Let's have a look at how we can deploy this. First, let's save our pipeline by clicking on Details, and let's enter our pipeline name. I'll call mine LangChain Chatbot, and I'll just do the same for the description. Let's save this pipeline, let's save these changes, then let's click on Deploy, and let's have a look at these different deployment options. We will create the chatbot in a second, but let me show you what this search option does. We can create a new search by giving it a name, like I'll call mine LangChain Pipeline, and under configuration, we can decide to use the entire pipeline or only the knowledge base. Let's leave it on pipeline. And our pipeline is called LangChain Chatbot, and we will be using the input and output nodes. Let's save this, and let's click on Export, let's click on Deploy, and now we can access this from this URL. Or we can simply click on this button, and now we have this search bar where we can interact with our pipeline. Let's again ask, what is LangChain Expression Language? Let's click on Search, and we got this response back, but we received this text in one big chunk, instead of it being streamed. We can actually set streaming in our application as well by closing this pop-up. Then on the LLM, click on Settings. Let's check Stream Response. Let's close this pop-up. Let's save this pipeline. Then we can go back to this search page. I'm actually going to refresh this. Let's ask the question again. What is LCEL? And this time we should see the response streaming in. Like so. So what I also want to show you is on this page, we have the ability to embed this search bar in our websites by simply copying this code snippet and pasting it into our website. And here you can see a few examples, like you can embed this into Wix, Squarespace, Framer, Webflow, WordPress, and other platforms. Now let's also have a look at deploying this as a chatbot. Let's click on Deploy, Chatbot, and here we need to specify a few things about our chatbot, like our chatbot name. I'll just call this LangChain Assistant. I'll just use the same for the description. Then for the pipeline configuration, we can leave everything as is. Let's save this. Let's go to Functionality. And on this screen, we can see a preview of our chatbot's window. Under Functionality, we can change the name of the chatbot, and I'll call mine LangChain Support. We can also change the name of the user, which is this value over here. And for the bot, let's give it a friendly name like Sammy. And we can also change the welcome message to something like, hello, how can I help you? We can also set an error message. So if something had to go wrong, how would the bot respond? And we can also set these toggles to keep the chat open, allow the user to stop the generation, allow the user to clear the chat. And if you are on one of the paid plans, you can also disable this powered by vector shift text by switching this off. And what's very cool is that we can also set suggested initial prompts. For instance, what is LCEL and whatever else. And you will see that option popping up here. So the user has the option of typing a message or to click on this button to get started. We can also change the styling of this pop-up by setting an icon URL, changing the colors, like the input colors, like so. And we can set some other values as well. And we can change the font. Let's save this. Let's click on export. And from export, we can deploy our chatbot, and we can also integrate this with WhatsApp or SMS using Twilio. We also have access to an API endpoint for interacting with this chatbot, and we also have integration with Slack. Let's simply go back to chatbot and let's click on deploy. This will give us a URL to access this chatbot directly. So let's click on open chatbot, and this will give us a ChatGPT-like interface for interacting with this chatbot. On the left, we have all the previous conversations, and on the main screen, we can start interacting with this bot. First, you will notice that input suggestion over here, and if I click that, I will get a response back. And we are getting a streaming result from the bot. And of course, we can still chat to the bot like normal. And we can also see that conversation showing up on the left-hand side, where we can rename this conversation or delete it. And this feature allows us to use our pipeline as a standalone chat application. Of course, we can also embed this chatbot into our websites by copying this snippet and pasting it into our website's code. If you enjoyed this video, then you might also enjoy some of my other no-code playlists on my channel.